I can call the Roseville City Council meeting to order for January 14th, 2014. May we please rise and pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, I'd like to thank the Recreation Authority and Tony Lipinski, the director, for his courtesy to let us host our meeting here tonight. We had a boiler breakdown at City Hall, so we were scrambling around to find a place to do it, and Tony graciously let us do it tonight, so I appreciate that. And to the Recreation Authority Chairman, Councilman Ayuda. So at this time, Mr. Clerk, we have a roll call of office.
Mayor Turkin?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Taylor?
Here.
Councilman Ayuda?
Here.
Councilwoman Hagerty?
Here.
Councilwoman Haw?
Here.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Here.
Councilman Shoemaker?
Here.
All members present, Mayor.
Thank you. Before we get started, are there anybody from the public that are here on any of the abatement of public nuisance properties? Anybody from the public here? Okay. Is there any item that the council wishes to have removed from the consent agenda and placed on the consent agenda item action? Okay, seeing none, then I'll ask for a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Support.
Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. During discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Presentations this evening, there are none. First is the hearing of the public. Public comments on agenda items only will be heard at the first hearing. You are welcome to direct questions and for information on express attendance of the council. Anyone using inappropriate language, you can call out of order and correct their language or leave the podium. Please limit your remarks time to exceed 3 minutes. Is there anybody wish to talk about agenda items this evening? Step up to the podium, sir. Give your name and address for the record.
Yeah, Dave Chesney, 30440 Normal. Yes, on agenda item D, 28109 O'Neill. Yeah, that property definitely needs to come down. My daughter's friend lives over there on O'Neill, and a lot of the residents are really, it's an eyesore to them. And I tell you, that 119-140 Colorado, foundation's crumbling. She's ready to come down. So if we can get them down, let's get these public nuisances down for the good of our city. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else wish to be heard on agenda items only this evening? Anybody else? Seeing now, we will move into new business. Public hearing and council consideration to adopt ordinance to amend the City of Roseville zoning ordinance by amending Article 2, General Sections, Sections 201, definitions to provide for the definition of an outdoor cafe, add complete streets to amend Article 12B-3, General Business Districts, Section 1202, principal uses, permit subject to special conditions to provide for outdoor cafes and internet cafes, dog daycare, dog grooming, and other dog service establishments, residential occupancy of two structures along certain items, certain areas along Gratiot Avenue, as principal uses permitted subject to special conditions to amend Article 20, off-street parking, parking layout, and loading and unloading standards, Section 2000, General Parking Requirements, to provide for a bicycle parking reduction, General Parking Reduction, to amend Article 21, Site Plan Review, Section 2100, Site Plan Process, to provide additional site plan review guidelines, to amend Article 23, General Provisions, to provide for Section 2318, governing complete street improvements with regulations and certain exceptions, to provide for repealer severability and effective date. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, I'll start and then I'll turn over to Mr. Tomlinson. I just want to make a comment that all of these items, although there are quite a few of those, and this will give time for the mayor to take a breath after reading all that, these items have been worked on for the past several months by the Planning Commission in concert with the planning consultant as well as the building director. And also, one of the items is in relation to the complete street legislation that was passed by the state legislature a couple of years ago. So there has been quite a bit of work put into this, and it is all part of the Gratiot redevelopment plan as well. That, I'll turn over to Mr. Tomlinson.
I think Mr. Atkins pretty much covered it. You have several additions to the zoning ordinance, some modifications, some additions to the various definitions that are included there, which play into these additional sections such as outdoor cafes, internet cafes, and the like. The one issue I just want to make sure is to clarify in the preamble read by the mayor, one of the sections is actually to allow the residential occupancy of two-story structures along certain areas of Gratiot Avenue. I think we may have left out the word story in that preamble portion, but that is clearly delineated within the body and within the substance of the ordinance. As indicated, Planning Commission has gone through this. They've held the various hearings on the matter, and it's before council as to your review and your adoption. And we suggest it be adopted as presented.
Are there any questions from Mr. Atkins regarding this? Mayor Pro Tem.
I guess this would be for Mr. Tomlinson. Tim, I noticed you got dog daycare and dog grooming. I mean, is this something new to the ordinance, or is this something we've already had? I mean, what actually was added to this? The outdoor cafe part? Or was all this stuff added?
All of the stuff that's included in this ordinance is new to the ordinance. It's permitted use subject to special conditions. Okay.
I don't know. Do we actually have a dog daycare outdoor grooming facility somewhere in Roseville? Because we do, I've never seen one.
We may not at this point, but it's obviously something that's trending towards the future. And when we look at the zoning ordinances through the planning consultant, they're looking at what other communities are dealing with in their communities and applying it to the other communities that they may represent. And they may have seen this as a use that's been requested. Oftentimes, if a permitted use is not specified within the zoning ordinance, then you're looking for a like or similar type of use under the general catch-all language of the zoning ordinance. This will further clarify with regard to those additional uses such as outdoor cafes, the residential occupancy of certain two-story structures within the Gratiot corridor. Those are things that have not been addressed. Internet cafes is another one. If you recall, we had some of these internet cafes at one point pop up, but we really didn't have a specific permitted use or permitted use with conditions provision. So that's why that's been added here, so that it makes it more comprehensive as to some of these uses that, although we may not have today, the trend is for these uses in the future. Another one's outdoor cafes, for instance. Although we may have some outdoor restaurants and establishments, we've generally done that on a piecemeal basis versus going through an actual ordinance.
Okay. That's all I have.
I have one question. Is the planning consultant and the building director, they went over this plan?
Yes. Yes.
And they've signed off on it?
Correct. They've been involved in the entire process.
I believe we do have one dog daycare center that's on off of Little Mac at 13 Mile by the Corneli facility. They do have outside right. So I'm wondering how that's going to affect them, because it says overnight stay of animals shall be prohibited, and I think they do have a hotel there.
Well, they would be considered a legal non-conforming use because they're already established prior to the adoption of the zoning ordinance.
Uh-huh.
So even if they don't meet the strict requirements of a dog daycare under this ordinance, they basically would be grandfathered in at this point.
But anybody new would not be allowed to do this.
Well, they'd have to comply with whatever the provisions of the ordinance are.
Which is very limiting as far as dog daycare. Okay.
Now, we may have some other provisions within other ordinances when it comes to kennels that deal with dog kennels, and that's where that would come into play, where you have the overnight stays.
Okay.
And in fact, I believe we have one. I think we restrict those to the industrial districts, if I'm not mistaken, because I think at one time we did have one of those hotels, for lack of a better term. And we may still have one.
That's the one that,
They probably.
Right.
And the Cornelia.
That's all I have, Mayor.
Any other questions? Seeing none, this is a public hearing. Is there anybody from the public that wish to be heard regarding this ordinance change? Anybody from the public wish to be heard? Seeing none, a motion to close the public hearing is in order.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hawes. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. What are the wishes of the council?
Chair, I'll make the motion to approve the request as presented.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney to approve as presented, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. Next item is request approval to appoint Michael Swatowski to the Recreation Authority of Roseville and Eastport Board for a 3-year term. I talked to our newly elected treasurer the other day, and he said he would be welcome to serve another 3 years on the board. So can I have a motion?
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried. Congratulations to the treasurer. Request approval to purchase redevelopment and property. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. As you're aware, some correspondence has been shared with you. We had an opportunity arise near the holidays. We were contacted by Fifth Third Bank. They had acquired a parcel in our redevelopment district along Utica and Gratiot, which is a parking lot. It's currently a 24-space parking lot. They acquired it as bank forfeited property. They were placing it back on the market and had offered to the city in the interest. I forwarded the information to you, and we've had it reviewed by Mr. Tomlinson. This is, again, in the area where we've recently acquired some redeveloped property that we plan on turning over for resale. This would be a benefit not only for the future sale of that property, but also for the businesses within that area, and requesting the council's consideration for the purchase of the property. Some further details that were, I believe, shared with you in your packet. The taxable value of the property this past year is approximately $26,000. It has a market value of $40,000, and we have put in an offer below what the bank was asking. However, they have tentatively accepted the offer, requesting council's consideration for approval of the purchase of the property. And $14,900 is the price.
Are there any questions from Mr. Mayor Pro Tem?
Mr. Atkins, this is for the two lots, right?
It is two lots off of Homer Street.
Right. Now, the one on Homer Street, that's directly behind the gas station, is that right? Am I correct?
It is. It appears that there may have been a vacated alley in between there, but it is located directly behind. If you can see maybe a little bit better on this copy. It's actually two parcels that are now combined for the parking lot. The parking lot takes the entire two parcels out. And it is quite a decent sized parking lot.
Now that's zoned residential?
It does abut a residential area, but it's right behind the current commercial zone property, so it's in commercial portion there. Residential is off of Homer Street and Elizabeth Street.
Yes, Scott, are they just waiting for our approval?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. So is this behind where the theater is?
It is across from the theater, actually kind of across the street from the theater off of Homer, between the gas station and the theater. Remember, the road kind of runs at an odd angle there off of Homer. So.
And there's an alleyway going from Homer over to Utica.
It's behind the gas station.
Yeah, the alleyway is located in between there. And if you might be able to see it a little bit better, even though it's kind of small on the Google aerial. That's the first cover. I indicated it as item number 2.
It's a gas station right there.
Well, the theater is right here.
It's right here.
So it's kitty corner from the theater.
Oh,
Mr. Atkins, does that have a wall around it?
A portion of it does have a wall, does have a wall between residential, that's already existing.
How are we gonna connect this to the tip top?
This would be tied in with any future development agreement for resale, or could potentially be included if council chooses.
You said price is $14.90?
$14.90, correct.
I'm aware of the property, and thought that Finial's next to them, they probably don't matter, is it adjacent residential?
This has been a longstanding parking lot, it's been there for quite some time, it's been fairly well maintained as well. Excuse me, and there are no environmental issues or any concerns, it's been reviewed by the building director.
I know those people, the residents there, do you have any questions?
It's actually a zone commercial.
That is.
I have one last, and maybe you may know, you maybe not, or you may not be privy to let us know, but is there people, are there people interested in that lot?
The bank has offered it to us first, it would go onto the market, obviously at a different price for anyone else that would be interested.
I mean, because it almost seems like this lot number two seems like that lot, you know what I mean? We're not wasting our money on it.
No, actually, even though you see two lots, that part, the parking surface does extend over the two lots currently out there.
So are we then going to repurchase this? Are we then going to put it up for sale, is that what we're doing, or are we waiting?
What we would intend to do is package it together with the other development property as one package to put forth with a development agreement specific to redevelopment of the first parcel that we purchased. The parking obviously is a concern, and I know it's probably a question that was raised by the planning commission. It's a benefit to have this property to prevent parking from going into the residential areas as well. So for any future development, it's certainly more marketable for us to control parking rather than force that into the neighborhoods. But it would be tied together.
Councilwoman Hawk, when they had the presentation on the first piece of property, there were some concerns by the planning commissioners and some of the residents about the parking. So this, or this purchasing this lot, alleviates some of that problem with the parking. Because the walkability, I think that's what they call it, from point A to point B is there. So if anybody, if that property does get developed, patrons can park there and then go over there. Are there any other questions? Seeing none, motion would be in order.
Mr. Mayor, I make the motion to approve the purchase of the redevelopment property that presented.
Support.
Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request awarding a bid for demolition of 28109 O'Neill. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor. As council may be aware, we do have a court order for demolition of the property on O'Neill. This did go out for bid. However, the bid came in at $7,675. That is $1,675 over the allowable threshold for our approval. Therefore, this needs to be approved by City Council.
Are there any questions regarding this property?
Is there a reason that it came in so high?
No, it was just the amount that it bid. This is the lowest recommended bid, however, but it was over the 7,500 threshold. But no specific reason as for that, that I'm aware of.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Mr. Atkins, obviously the city owns this property right now, correct?
No.
We don't own it.
Just has a court order for demolition.
Okay, so if we wanted to use this for like our, like for some kind of training, like our fire department or our SWAT team or something like that, would that be out of the question?
That's probably more of an answer for me.
I mean, before it got bulldozed, I mean, because I mean, they're all, like I said, they're always looking for training facilities, and I'm just thinking if we threw it out to them, I mean.
Technically, we have authority over the structure at this point with regard to the demolition. You don't own the property itself, though. That continues to maintain in Ms. Ferguson's name. Any cost of demolition will be placed against the property as a lien. In these types of circumstances, I would recommend that we don't utilize it.
Okay. All right. That's all I have.
Any other questions? The motion is in order.
Mayor, I'll approve the request as presented.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilwoman Hawk. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is appointments, and I have a few appointments to make. For the Citizens Advisory Committee, Rose Butler, Tim Hosty, and Margaret Rollinger. Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Alito, supported by Councilwoman Hall. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next is for the Board of Review, Joe Montgomery. First term to fill vacancy through February 1st, 2016. Michael Crocker, reappointed for second term, February 1st, 2014 through February 1st, 2017. And the alternate is Thomas Trako, first term, February 1st through 2014 through February 1st, 2017. So can I have a motion?
So moved.
Motion by Mayor Prochem Taylor to approve the appointment, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is reports from administration departments. Mr. Clerk, do you have anything this evening?
Yeah, Mayor, I would just like to bring council up to speed in the public with regard to the SAFER grant that was approved by council previously. We put the hiring process for entry-level fire on a fast track. We successfully completed that process, and I believe that three firefighters were hired off the prior list that recently expired. And they're in the process now of doing the background investigation to hire the following three to complete the complement of six that were approved in the SAFER grant. As far as entry-level police, we are in the process. We've completed the first phase. We put it out for advertisement. We got 46 applications. We had 29 applicants actually show up to take the written exam. And we have completed the first round of portion of the testing, and we are scheduling the oral interviews for February the 2nd, I believe. And that process will begin, and that's on a fast track as well. So just bringing it up to speed with regard to entry-level police and fire. Do you have any questions?
Anybody have any questions for the clerk? Seeing none, we'll move on to reports of city management.
Yes, Mayor. Thank you. Excuse me. To add on a little bit to the clerk's report in reference to the police department, we are anticipating still hiring yet five more officers. And then that will bring us up to the completion of the hiring that we began almost a year ago. So it's been a long process, but we're in the stretch to be able to complete that. Reminder that city offices will be open on Monday, January 20th, which is Martin Luther King Jr. Day. The library is offering, again, another slew of activities coming up. They have programs such as Club Bead, American Rosie the Riveter program, and several others, as you know, are very exciting. However, they are so numerous to mention, and we're referring folks to the city Facebook site and the library's webpage, which is roseville library.org, or contact the library by telephone. They'd be glad to fill you in on all of their wonderful programs. Also, I don't see Charlotte here this evening, but on her behalf, I would remind you that January is Youth Art Month in Roseville. And we know she's very proud of that, as well as her group, so we continue to celebrate Art Month this month. The mayor indicated at the beginning of the meeting that we had an issue with the boiler system. It was actually dealing with the igniter at City Hall. It disabled the system. Yesterday, the temperature dropped into the 60s overnight, dropped further into the 50s, and it was a little frigid this morning. So city offices were closed. There were probably about a half dozen or more people that were in today, kind of braving the temperatures. And I can report that the boilers have been fired back up. Repair has been made. Knock on wood and cross our fingers, we'll hope that that patch will work and get us through the winter. So it does take a number of hours for the heat to rise back up. So before I left, the council chambers were still a little bit too frigid, but we hope to be back up in full operation tomorrow, and again, cross our fingers that that problem will be resolved. Again, thank you everyone for your patience, and anyone who may have had any bills that they went to pay today, I don't believe we had anything due, but if there was a due date of today's date, it will be extended and no penalty charged. Also, a number of residents may have received or may be receiving letters from an organization called HomeServe. It'll be kind of in a tan color, or I guess manila, light color envelope. This is another solicitation to try to sell insurance for utility lines. Again, it is not required that residents purchase any type of insurance for water or sewer utilities. The city council, as you're aware, did endorse a company. However, this is not one of the companies, and again, even for a company that may have been endorsed or given a green light, residents are not required to purchase any additional insurance for water or sewer lines. But this is the time of year where a number of these letters from different organizations will be coming out, and if residents have any questions, they can feel free to contact the manager's office. We'd be glad to provide assistance. Again, with this time of year, as you're all aware, we've had a number of issues dealing with snow over the past couple of weeks. Unfortunately, those came on top of holidays. It kind of complicated things, and they were substantial snow events. As you realize, we did declare two snow emergencies. We had a great amount of compliance from our residents, but we did have some issues where we had to have vehicles ticketed and towed. I know that our Public Works Department did the best that they could in light of the circumstances with snows back-to-back and with holidays. I just want council and residents to be aware that we did work all of those folks, of course, among safe parameters, but they were working 16-hour days, and we really couldn't push them past that for safety's sake, not just for the drivers, but also our residents. But we did get them out there every day consistently for at least 16 hours. We alternated the shifts, so we actually had a couple of different sets of folks out there. And we do realize that it did cause some issues for residents. But unfortunately, these snow events are beyond our control, so we appreciate everyone's patience and understanding. After the snow left, as you know, we've had a brief little thaw cycle, and now that brings the next nightmare that we have, and those are potholes. We, as well as many other communities, the state highway system, the county roads, are all experiencing these problems with these potholes that pop up rather quickly. Generally, we will get on those right away when they pop up. If they happen after hours in the evening or on the weekends, we actually have to call a crew in. So it does take some time for the crew to come in, get to the public works yard, grab the equipment, and be able to get out to make these repairs. But again, we take this very seriously. We try to get on those repairs as quickly as possible. And we know that a pothole can grow in size from just a small little saucer size to, you know, a 3-foot gaping hole rather quickly. We take it very seriously, but we know that in many cases, it's difficult for people to understand if they've hit a pothole, that it does take time for the crew to get there to get that patch out. And if someone experiences a pothole, please contact during normal hours our city hall, our Department of Public Works office, so we can get a crew out there. If it's after hours, please contact the police department, and they have a notification system to get a hold of our DPW. Those are the items that I have. I'd be glad to answer any questions from council that you may have.
Are there any questions for me?
Thank you, Mayor. DPW did a great job, I think, with the cleanup. But just talking, you know, touch base on those potholes, when do they start the patch? Is that more close to spring for all the streets?
Well, the general patching will be springtime, but pothole patching, as soon as we're aware of the potholes, we'll immediately go out and patch those. And I mean, as you see on several of our streets, there is a fresh color of black cold patch out there. And it's difficult at this time of year to even keep that patch held in place.
Right.
But they will go out and repatch, and then we'll do the formal patching that you may be referring to in the spring. Generally after the asphalt plant's open and it gets warm enough for that patch to be put in place. But what we're putting out there right now is called the cold patch mix, and it is not intended to be a very long-term mix for some of these holes. They'll have to go back and make a more extensive repair.
Thank you.
Scott, you might want to explain that there's county and state roads.
Right.
And so we're, you know, you can notify us, but they're the ones.
Correct. Good point, Mayor. We have had some confusion because we do have a number of roads. Our local streets are under our jurisdiction. So these are side streets, Sycamore, Florida, and those type of streets. In some cases, Little Mac, Masonic. However, the Macomb County Road Commission has jurisdiction over the mile streets, so 12 mile, 13 mile, 14 mile. They handle those streets. As far as Gratiot and Grosbeck and I-696 and 94, those are the Michigan Department of Transportation. So certainly anybody can call in any of the issues to our police department, and we'll pass it along. But understand that in some cases it is not our street, so we have to share that information with the other agency or vice versa. Someone may be calling the Michigan Department of Transportation or the County Road Commission with an issue that is not their street. We're now dependent on them to notify us of that. And I will tell you that we have noticed that there have been some cases where maybe a call was made to the road commission. Again, if it's an after-hours call, there may be a delay before they get that phone call to us. But we will act as quickly as we can, and we will also share information to the other agencies as quickly as we can. But there are a number of different owners of these streets. They're not all city streets.
Any other questions from Mr. Atkins this evening? And then we'll move into reports of city attorney, Mr. Thomas.
Thank you, Mayor. I do have a couple things I want to report on. Is we've had some previous discussions about this in Macomb Animal Control Coalition, that we're seeking to do a consortium with a number of other communities that have their own animal control departments, such as the city of Roseville. That is finally coming to fruition. The resolutions are in their final form. We will be bringing that to the next special meeting for further discussion with council, and then eventually adoption of those resolutions in the interlocal agreement with the other agencies and other cities. That's the main thing I have to report on tonight. The second thing is the court system in particular, the 39th District Court. I've had a request from them to look at and review our handicap parking ordinance, and there are some modifications and revisions we're going to be proposing on that ordinance, so you can expect to see that on your agenda as well in the near future to deal with that. And the last thing is actually a clarification matter on the winter parking ordinance that I'm going to bring to the council for some decision as to which route we want to go as far as some penalties and how those are handled. Currently, we have language to the effect that those involved in a snow emergency receive a $50 ticket. Those involved in the general violation of the snow parking ordinance are subject to a $20 ticket. But if they come to court within so many days of those tickets, you can compromise it, and it'll be compromised to 50%. The ordinance reads a little unclear as to whether that applies to both the $50 and the $20 ticket. I think the intent at one point was that it should only apply to the $20 ticket, but we want to bring that back before council just for clarification purposes, because it has arisen due to the fact that we've had these recent snow emergencies, and whether or not that's going to be imposed as a full boat ticket or if it's going to be subject to a 50% reduction for those snow emergency tickets. Currently, what we're doing, we're taking the side of caution, erring on the side of caution and allowing the 50% reduction, but we want to know in the future which way to go with council. So those are the two items I have to report this evening. I'm happy to answer any other questions.
Are there any questions for Mr. Thomas? Seeing none, we'll move to the second hearing of the public. Second hearing of the public will be for any city business. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address. You're welcome to direct questions, inquiry, information, express opinions to the council. Anyone using inappropriate language, if you call out of order in the correct language, please limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. So anybody from the public wish to be heard this evening? Anybody from the public?
Yes.
Good evening, City Council. Pierre of Judah, 28945 Utica Road. One question, how come the city doesn't have a separate zoning board of appeals?
I'll answer your questions after you conclude your remarks.
Okay. Second question is, in August of 2012, we called the city water department to have the water turned off. In December of that year, we had my uncle went in and signed a formal written request to turn the water off. Well, the water never got turned off. February 8th, my water pipes busted, flooded the office, did a lot of damage. What is a reasonable amount of time to turn off the water? Excuse me. I get my water bill, first water bill, just had the water turned on in August. Get my first water bill, I used one unit. I got charged for 335 units of my water bill. I went to the garage, talked to Tom Aiuto, talked to him, asked to see my old meter. Well, he hasn't called me back yet. I called the city attorney, and I guess he hasn't gone to the garage yet. My meter, my outside meter reads one number. My inside meter reads another number. I thought it was just me. Went to other businesses, same thing. Their outside reads different than their inside. Went to the city hall. The meter that they got on display reads different. Their outside meter, the remote meter, reads different than their inside meter. I got charged, my first water bill for using one unit, I got charged almost $2,200. I mean, how long does it really take to turn off the water? 5 months? 2 months? That's all I have to say.
Okay, as far as your zoning board, the city charter dictates how we do our zoning, and the city charter says the council will act as a zoning board. On your other items, I will have the city manager contact the water director and find out what seems to be the problem with your water meter and the question that you got billed for so much for one unit.
I paid for it, my water meter broke, I paid to put a new water meter in.
The only thing I could tell you, sir, is that if you look at all our water bills and our city announcements, we always say to the residents,
compare your outside to your inside.
And if there's a difference, please call the water department.
Yeah, but if you ever look at my past bills, my outside meter has always been red. They've always used the outside meter number, not the inside meter. They've never checked the inside meter on the place.
Okay, we'll make sure that that happens.
Even the city office.
I do, Mayor, I will provide, excuse me, a written response to the gentleman and also the council. Mr. Iudo and I and Mr. Townsend have talked on this matter several times. I've spoken to the gentleman a couple times, and I'll be glad to put a response back to you in regards to the issue.
All right, thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Anybody else from the public wish to be heard?
Yes, Dave Chesney, 30440 Normal. I just wanted to comment on the good work that the DPW did at the clearing the snow within, like, you know, getting all the side streets and that within 3 days of that big snowstorm. And just want to say they go out here and they do a great job. And they can only work, you're right, 16-hour days, and then they have to stop for a while. I know I used to do it. I know how it is. Another thing I'd like to bring up that's of importance to the city of Roseville and all of our surrounding communities is the problem of scrappers. You know that in Wayne County and Detroit, last summer, they just put in new lights on I-94 between 8 Mile and Cobb. They spent like $18 million. I don't know if you've seen them new lights. Do you know you go down there now, them lights aren't even working because the scrappers have got hold of the copper wire and are just destroying the whole system. That's why half the lights down there don't work anyway. It's a serious major problem in the city of Detroit, but you know the scrapper subculture is starting to start out here. And we need to band together with our courts, our police, and really get a tackle on this scrapping subculture. Because, boy, I tell you, once a house, they see that something's empty for a minute, they just swoop in like vultures and destroy. So, but if you want to see what they really did, look at what they did to the new lights on 94. It's terrible. I mean, they spent all this money, millions of dollars. The scrappers have, and the trouble is, They don't care. They don't care if they get electrocuted trying to steal scrap. It needs to stop for the health and the safety of our entire region. And I do want to say about that, behind that Marathon station, you can cut over to Elizabeth from Homer. Nobody uses that parking lot. A lot of people do cut across through there, so that's what they do use it for, because I do. I just want to say that thanks, and the scrapper issue needs to be addressed in this entire region. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Anybody else?
Hello, Mayor, Council. Vince Warnchuk for 26051 Ballinger. And I had all the permits pulled and everything. This guy's name is Sam Lucheri, and I just found out from Glenn Saxon that he can't pull him no more. He's doing it all illegal. And he did the work, and now I can't get anybody to do, you know, pull the permits, because nobody wants to touch it because they'll be liable. I tried to talk to Glenn, and I called you, Mr. Mayor.
I understand, Mr. Mayor. But I'm not going to get into a debate with you over your properties. I've had Mr. Sexton, I've passed on the information you gave me to him. I don't know if he's contacted you back yet.
Yeah, he says I can't help you, get new contractors, and in the meantime, he's supposed to give him a check, he says, hold on, now he says, in other words, forget about it, you know, you're stuck, you know. And I spent $5,000, and I've been here 4 months trying to get this house straightened out, you know, get out of red tag, and, you know, it's waiting for the deal. So, they're not trying to help me.
Mr. Tomlinson.
I think, number one, when we say we're not trying to help them, this is an issue that's been going on for years. I mean, this is not an issue that is.
I know, but I wanted to fix it. If you would have told me 4 months ago.
Mr. Warnchuk, right now, the city attorney's got the floor.
And I understand that, Mr. Warnchuk, and I'm not going to get in disagreement with it, but there comes a point that you were an absentee landlord for years and didn't address the issues. The house became so dilapidated that we had to begin nuisance abatement proceedings, citing you, et cetera. To be quite frank, we can't handhold you all the way through this whole process. You have a duty to hire contractors that are competent. That's not our job. You know, you put yourself in this position. We didn't put you in this position. We've given you as much rope and leeway as we possibly can. And, you know, Mr. Sexton, he's always very accommodating in trying to assist residents with their properties, and he has in this case. And he's advised you that if you want to have a rehab, then you're going to have to hire a different or competent contractor to do the work. And he's not going to do the legwork for you. You can't expect him to do that. That's not his job.
Well, what are my chances of this guy, Sam O'Sherry, he's been, you know, messing everybody up, you know, saying he's pulling permits and...
Mr. Warnchuk, that's a civil matter, and we have no control over that. You can't force him to do your work. So, on the advice of Mr. Tomlinson, I would suggest to you that you find somebody that can do the work and get the work done, or if not, and you want to walk away from the house, then we'll do what we have to do.
Well, that's what you're want me to do now. I know if you, Glenn, would have told me that 4 months ago, I wouldn't have spent $5,000 in 4 months here, you know?
Mr. Sexton's been patient with you, because I can remember this going all the way back to 2009 when I visited you.
I know, but that was the same guy, you know, the guy who pulled permits before. I didn't know he lost his license. Glenn told me that
Okay.
I'm sorry, you know, I'm trying, you know, the guy was... You know, and what are my chances? The guy last year, that was his buddy, and he pulled, you know, it's just been a nightmare, you know, I'm sorry.
And you'll have to conclude your remarks now.
What about the water bill? It's up to $424. The guy hasn't paid 6 months. Why can't you shut him off so I can get rid of him? You know?
I will make sure that the city manager takes care of that.
Yeah, it's on 25961 Dale. The guy, he wants me to stay there. My name is Vincent, but I'm not saying Vincent and Paul. They should be out, you know?
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Anybody else? Okay. Seeing none, with motions or items for discussion by City Council. Councilwoman Hall.
Thank you, Mayor. First of all, I'd like to congratulate all the new appointees with their different positions, and I also would like to extend my condolences to Scott Brzezinski, head of our maintenance department, in the passing of his mother. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you. Councilman Shoemaker.
Pass my condolences off to Scott, too, and wish everybody a happy new year.
Thank you. Councilman Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor. Condolences out to Scott, and we all made it through the cold so far. And just take care of each other when it gets that bad out there. We still got a little bit of cold ahead of us. Go ahead.
Thank you. Councilman McCurdy.
Again, condolences to Scott. Passing of his mom, and have a happy new year, everyone.
Councilwoman Hager.
Mayor, my condolences to Scott as well, and I'd like to thank the DPW for doing a good job. It was a tough job. We had a lot of snow and a lot of aggravation for everyone, but they got us through. They did a lot of hard work, and I appreciate their efforts. And that's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you. Ironically, on the first Tuesday in January, I think it was the 7th, we were supposed to take up...
I'm not here. I'll slide back this way. Hey, go ahead.
No, I was wondering if I'd meet you.
You're the mayor. You run the show.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I just want to add a couple things. You know, everybody thanked our DPW for the work they did with the cleaning up, but also our water department. Unfortunately, we had a water main break out here in front of the recreation center, and ironically, my daughter happened to spot it, and she called me up, "Dad, there's a water main break out by the rec center." So I drove by and I looked at it, and I happened to call, and I didn't mention my name. I didn't, you know, that's not the way I operate. But the fellow on the other end of the line says, "Oh my gosh, not another one." So apparently, our city had a lot of water main breaks, and you know, gotta love our DPW and our water department, because I'll tell you what, it was cold out there. Everybody knows how cold it got. And I'm going to tell you something, they were out there braving the cold, and they were out there digging their holes, and they were, I mean, I got to give them a lot of credit. I mean, you just walk outside your house, the wind would take, you know, take the wind right out of you. And these guys out there digging holes, and they were out there hours on end, so I want to really thank them. And obviously, our police and fire, our fire department had that very extensive fire over on Little Mac that they had to fight the other day, and I want to get well wishes to our two firefighters that were injured out there. It's been a rough couple weeks here, even though it's been cold, but you know, our city workers have did a heck of a job, and I want to thank every one of them. And also I'd like to thank our new reappointees to the Citizens Advisory and the Board of Reviews. They do a great job, and I just want to thank them for their services and their continued services. And that's all I have.
Thank you. You know, when I thought this was going to be easy because we just go down the line and I still jumped in. Yeah. So anyways, ironically, we were supposed to have a council meeting the first Tuesday, and we were going to take up the issue of the infrastructure in City Hall and the police department and the library. Now, unfortunately, it caught up with us a little bit too quick, and the furnace went out, or the boiler went out. Because I'd like to apologize to the citizens for any inconvenience we might have had if you came to City Hall to pay a water bill or a tax bill. Hopefully we'll be up and running back tomorrow. I'd like to commend our DPW for all the hard work that they did during the snow removal. And we did receive communication from the garbage contractor, Rizzo Services, and he applauded the way that our guys did the snow plowing. So they could get the garbage picked up on time on a timely basis. And they only had a 1 day delay, so that was pretty good as far as I'm concerned. I know that the residents, I got some phone calls. You know, it's the snow season, and the plows come down the side streets. They do plow snow up in your driveway. Please be patient. I know I had to take the snow out of my driveway a couple of times, because that's, unfortunately, when you have plowed streets, that's one thing that you get driveways full of snow. But just bear with us, and apologize for any inconvenience. And like the city manager said, you know, it's pothole season. I've seen it on TV today, all over the city and the counties. If there is a pothole and it's a big size, and your car either gets messed up or it's there, and you notice it every time you get on, please call the police department or the city hall to have it fixed, because it'll save maybe your neighbor from getting their tire punctured or whatever. But you know, it's the season, and we want everybody to not go through that. Like Mr. Atkins said, we'll notify the county or the state if we have a pothole on one of the city or county roads. With that, I wish to Scott Brzezinski my condolences to you and your family in passing your mother. And with that, a motion to adjourn. Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilman Hall. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?